Thank you very much, Chair. I must say that the CV you have is pretty
dated.
But
curriculum it doesn't matter. Que vous venez de citer,
kind of credit. I hope the references to the positions which are now held by other people do not mean that they come after me for being an imposter. But, Mr. Director General, I want to thank you very much for this invitation and also for making this morning an African Women's Morning, led, of course, by my young sister, Grassa, there, who I want to say brought the third dimension. The debate which we normally have at international institutions. I was for many years the Deputy Director General of the International Labour Organization, and I know that a lot of these meetings could be very staged and on paper. Madame, you brought work, recounting your own experiences, which I think would focus very much the conclusions we will have. Again, in preparing for this particular occasion, I was looking for an angle which really would not be repeating what is already in the literature. I thought of how to push the envelope a little bit. And I decided, therefore, to make my focus Africa, you know, to talk about the importance of migration as a powerful strategy for poverty reduction in Africa, and also to force attention to softer issues, even as we bring out issues which would relate to the macroeconomy, etc., to let us look at the impact of migration on real people. And I want to talk about the importance of remittances in the African situation.
Dans le contexte africain.
We know that remittances have increased dramatically, and especially in Africa, migration, therefore, has offered a hope and opportunities for escaping from poverty. We also have the conflict-ravaged areas where people have felt the need to move. I will say that the whole migration agenda has managed to bail out many from life-threatening situation.
It's offered a vital lifeline.
I would like to draw attention to the impact of migration, say, on a village in Africa. We find that apart from the improvement in the quality of life of villages, we have a situation where the family with the most migrants, people living in the US, etc., even gain in stature in the village. To a point that we have for our funerals, we have obituaries where you have a list of the people who are relatives of the deceased, and where against the names of the some of the relatives, you will have where they come from. So a family which would have one child in the USA, they would write. Then they write the next one in Germany, the next one in South Africa, the next one. Then everybody knows that is a successful family. So it's even having an impact in terms of the social standing. No wonder then that parents would encourage their children to migrate in order to improve the quality of life of the family materially but even social. This is the soft part of migration which would need to be studied in great detail. As a result, we have got Africa where peasant farming is so very important, confronting a situation where agricultural production is actually going down because people are moving their children to migrate, to leave. And as a result, you have the farming population aging. And this is impacting on agricultural productivity. This is not going to change soon, unless we let things through deeply and see how to reverse the migration. As my sister Graça told us, we should create situations where people would just want to stay at home. Why should they migrate? So this is a policy issue which needs to be studied and which needs to be factored into the debate. It should be a cause for study as to how, for example, African governments can work to stop the young people moving away. But as I say, there are these social implications. Now we also have a situation where, because people move to the cities, we have an impact on urbanization, which is most undesirable. I always say that our cities and towns, big towns in Africa, are so crowded because they are nothing but transit camps for people who want to go out. So it's a holding situation. It's not that they want to go and find work because there's no work anywhere in many of our cities, but this is what will give them the link to the kinds of people who will give them the opportunity to move out. And we need, therefore, to confront this situation. In Asia, especially, we know that there are more structured ways of giving advantage to people who want to migrate. And I'm hoping that through the exchange of opinion and information, in addition to trying to encourage people to stay, because you don't create the situation for them to go away, to also try to structure better and formalize the movement of people out of the country, especially seeking greener pastures. What we also find is that when people come to the city, they find it impossible to go home because they will lose faith. So it's a very difficult situation to handle. The downside, of course, is what we are seeing, that then there are these young, sometimes even old, but gullible, simple people, find that they can be easily taken advantage of, which is part of this human trafficking tragedies we are seeing. The way to handle this is however to try to structure the whole area. I think this is important. Now let me also focus a little bit on the gender implications of migration. I think this has been studied to some extent. But again, I want to bring in the African situation we have, where migrants tend to send money home to their mothers. You know, especially where you have matrilineages, as we have in many tribes in Africa, you find that the remittances tend to reach women who are more likely to use it for family welfare. And therefore, facilitating these remittances, we've heard a little bit from Mr. Sutherland about how to make the remittances really reach the beneficiaries, becomes important. But I want to submit that certainly Migration is not gender neutral. Thing. And I would hope that within the context of the post 2015 agenda, you will really focus on women, on this whole gender would be an important component. That we look at the issue of the feminization of migration within the context of international migration. We also know that the women who become migrants tend to suffer more. The issues of conditions of work, exploitation by the employers, especially those who go in as domestic workers, etc. I don't want to go on for too long, but I just want to draw attention to this particular phenomenon and to encourage in the debate that we treat the issue of gender as important. I would also make a plea to the African Union to, as they try to forge a common position on the post 2015 development agenda, to work with the IOM on some issues I don't want to refer to now, but which are peculiar to the African situation. We can just join the debate, the international debate, in a bland manner. But what I would want us to do really is to try to push the African dimension, to bring in our own peculiarities, what makes us tick, what makes people move, etc., to put our case in this manner, and not necessarily just try to follow the African agenda. Well, I would want to talk also about the issue of displaced persons. I know that a lot of the debate focuses on people moving out internationally. But the situation we have in Africa is where we have a large number of internally displaced. So I think also that an important component of the post 2015 debate should focus on in-country migration, people who do not necessarily want to move, but have to move as a result of conflict, etc., and to say that these issues of governance countries must be encouraged to reduce, because it can even be worse than the internet. There are no laws, there are no guidelines, there are no rules as to how internally displaced people are treated. I know there are some things in the books, but they have not been treated as an important point to be researched, and so that you really have agreed criteria in this regard. I hope that this will be looked at. Let me just end by, I have a prepared paper, but I'm not really reading because I just want to draw out a few ideas. I want to say that this question of tracking, the tracking of impact, etc., which you refer to. I'll just that because the issue of migration within the nexus of the development agenda so cross-cutting, unless there's a conscious attempt to priorité.
Après 2015,
what is the most important?
Il faut établir les priorités.
One might find that one is dealing with so many entry points that you need.
Il y a tellement de points d'entrée.
So it's not as if I have any specific recommendation.
Donc ce n'est pas comme
but
si
I'm encouraging the council, not to try to do everything and be everything to all people.
Tout faire that, et que tout le monde
your
tout,
challenge
finalement.
Really is to identify where you can make the greatest impact, which brings me to the issue of partnership. You see, because again of the subject matter, the nature of the subject matter, there are so many people also working in the areas where you want to. So the important thing would be to identify who are the most important partners in each particular subject area. For example, if one looked at the world of work issue, we know that the International Labour Organization has got all these recommendations, standards, etc. And they have the machinery to be tracking. It's not necessary to reinvent the wheel or try to install something separate. The challenge really is to either make sure you piggyback or identify areas where there's a lacuna, where there's a and then try to
et d'essayer
fashion those for purposes of tracking.
D'adapter.
But at the end of the day, you create a database
where
you'll be able to know what is happening.
Qui permet de savoir ce qui se passe.
You create a sort of cockpit where you see what is happening out there and how to ensure that the areas which you have identified as the most important
are not
left up.
Et s'assurer que ces sujets-là ne sont pas
idem relations not with just the international institutions but also with civil society, with think tanks, etc. You have a lot of them working in the same area. So in face of shortage of resources, to be extremely focused
and
not to try to do everything. I want to say that the partnerships, therefore, should be
one of the key words for this.
But in addition, also focusing on the need to identify,
to
improve the advocacy,
to think of creating
champions in all of these institutions whose work also focus on
what you do,
and then try to use them to be your advocate. My final word really goes to the need to ensure that what is put down is implemented.
We find
that there a lot of nice words are put down, nothing happens internationally. The reason is because the resolutions are not incorporated with domestic law, which means you talk a lot, but in the end,
the
legs for implementation
are not
there because they are not incorporated in the laws, etc. In fact, in the field of migration, the same thing goes for migration policy. If we look at how migration is treated in countries, it's scattered all over the world because of the nature of the subject matter. And I know that IMO is already working with governments, but there's need to push more for consolidation of migration policy. You know, I was chief advisor to the president of Ghana, and what I saw there was when you have a subject matter scattered across so many ministries, you can say you have an interministerial committee dealing with things, but forget it. These things are just there a lot of the time on paper. What the IMO might think is to help to have consolidated migration policy, consolidated migration law, I'm talking of at the national level to get these things to be adopted by the countries themselves. Otherwise, you are talking into the wind. They sign on the documents and so on, they go home. During question time, if there are any issues, I could go back to my paper. But I really don't want to take too much of your time. And thank you very much for the opportunity to intervene. Thank you.